Welcome back. Well, apologies for that, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But now we are joined by Pastor Osani Osani, who is the Minister of Niger Delta Affairs, to focus on the goings-on in the region. Good morning, and thank you for coming on today.
Okay.
Well, let us start off with that, because, I mean, lately, several reports about the attacks, the pipeline vandalization, security agencies moving in to see how they could stop all of those. What are you doing about all of this to ensure that at least peace is also restored to the area?
Well, the region, as you know, the issues of pipeline vandalization is as old as the agitation in the region. And for what we are doing, is guided by the exigencies of any particular moment. First being that whatever we need to do will fall within the confines of regulatory law and the mandates that we get. Of course, there are different agencies, there are different establishments that are having a responsibility in the Niger Delta. And in so doing, especially concerning security, we all have formed a collaboration, and each one of the agencies carrying out its peculiar function, but in exchange of whatever we need to do to be able to make sure this distraction stops. However, it is regrettable that from two perspectives, I am personally very concerned that the people in the region do not understand the backward devastation that this activity causes for the people and for the region. From another perspective, the role that government has to play by the passionate disposition to rehabilitate the already very devastated area, which we don't seem to understand. But in all, we will continue to want to appeal to the people to see reason with government, and even see reason for the loss of their habitation, which also brings about the loss in their vocation in agriculture, both aquatic and terrestrial. So, but to answer your question, you know, having some security implications, yeah. It may be difficult to say everything that we are doing, but definitely no one is sleeping, and we are still continuing.
Are you engaging with them, and what kind of results are you getting?
Well, it becomes very difficult to say the results we get are sustainable, because we are engaging from different perspectives and at different levels. Nonetheless, the complexity of the situation is such that when you hear some people say they belong to a particular group headed by somebody, mm-hmm. and after a while, somebody who's been a subordinate maybe for some years, series that is of reckoning to also form his own group and lead a team to begin to attract attention, he falls out with maybe 10, 20, 15 people and begins another form of this agitation, which is really not agitation for the people. And it continues. But as much as we are engaging them, we are getting information relating to current upsurges. But I think we need to realize that if we that are causing this harm are from the region, we must be sympathetic and empathic, of course, to the lives of those vocations we are destroying.
Is the Niger Delta Avengers one of such groups that you just highlighted, maybe fell out to a group of people and then formed?
Well, from the findings we are having, they had come under a certain auspice in the past. We're still getting information from the background, and the name they gave themselves in the past has somewhat a coloration to an event that took place earlier, and they were responding to it. And now they feel that one is gone, they have to identify themselves in another perspective and do something probably worse that will attract the attention of government. The attention of government is already attracted. We don't need all that to be attracted to give attention to the region. So all we need is collaboration and, you know, cooperation of the people so that the government can do what they want to do.
You know, you said the agitations in the Niger Delta are not new, but the conversation, what you said here, cooperation and dialogue with them, these are things they've continued to hear over and over again. The people in the Niger will tell you that they've heard promises before and they've not been met. What are the guarantees you're putting on the table for them to even sit down and have conversations with government?
Yes. Now, for the manifestation of whatever we put on the table to have results, we'll suggest first, what are their demands? Are they able to come out and say, these are our demands? And if those demands amount to what can give livelihoods and sustain the livelihoods in the region, then you can consider that they are making genuine demands. Now, the things we are putting on the table are things that are holistic in societal development. The first consideration will be, why would government continue to give stipend under the amnesty program? It is because they want people for now to have a palliative on which they can rest while other more permanent things are being done. Number two, the massive infrastructure design on the master plan of the region, which is being pursued, in spite of the fact that there are limitations in the resource application because the terms are so suggestive. Number three, the fact that different agencies are entrusted with these responsibilities. But the dilemma is that with the persuasions of agitating groups as many, it becomes difficult to say you satisfy all because each one comes with their own dimensions of demands. So what we are putting on the table is first to demonstrate to the public, society, the nation, the region, and its inhabitants that the government is ready and willing to rehabilitate the people. Remember, for some years ago, there had been the UNEP report on Ogoniland. And this is the moment we are just about to start the cleanup. We've been holding interministerial, programming, conferencing, and not up to 3 weeks ago, we had such one right in Port Harcourt, where Ogoni leaders, the youths, women groups were invited to make sure that as we come in for the activity, people cooperate with government so there will be peace and security for that to take place. Then, ask yourself, if this is going on and there's no guarantee of the lives of the people who are carrying out the cleanup for our own good, can we go on? Beyond this, the government is having an expanded program, not just for the Ogoni land, knowing that the entire area is polluted. Government wants to extend it even further. And so we are mopping resources for that. Therefore, we are able to demonstrate that government wants to rehabilitate the region. Short as the administration has come on board.
You know, security matters is very key here. That's why most Nigerians are excited that you're here, getting to see that the region is again coming to the fore and not in any way good. People are concerned, and that is why Chamberlain asked the question, have you been meeting with these ones? Has there been any kind of representative from the Niger Delta Avengers? Now, let's be calling some of the names that have popped up, and that is one of those names that we have seen lately. Is there any kind of communication between your ministry and this new group?
Oh, fine. So far, by our undercurrent findings, we have sent emissaries to see how we can identify and meet with them. But we are told they've gone underground. Probably because maybe of some scare or apprehensions. For the other groups, when I say there are different government agencies engaged in different things all about the region, is that in the form of our collaboration, we continue to detail and assign, for instance, the management of the Niger NDDC, the Amnesty Program advisor or chairman. He continues in this engagement. And at the level of the ministry, given our mandate, we should necessarily coordinate the policies and development of the region. And as they do this, we get back, discuss, redesign, and carry on another approach. But some groups have also come from the region, meeting with us at the ministry level. The chiefs have come, the oil community producing leaders have come, the Ijaw Youth Council leaders have come, and so on and so forth. We've got them, coming and we're discussing, and also engaging them with these other agencies of, the region.
You know, mentioning the chiefs, what comes to mind here is the traditional institution, which is very key in that region. What has been the discussion with these traditional rulers who have met with you?
A lot of them that have come to pledge cooperation with government. A lot of them that have come have also indicated their endorsement of government's plan in this administration concerning the region. And even as at this morning, I've got a message of some of them who are still willing to come. But there is a disconnect between these facets of people in the region. It does appear the chiefs don't have the overwhelming control over those who do these things. And so, much as they are willing and they pledge to do what is proper, I do not think they have the authority to contain the people who carry out the activities that are nefarious.
Is government meeting with the IOCs and some of the oil majors in the region that have been
government,
victim to this
government is
act?
Government is, because the of course some of these meetings, because of their strategic nature, it's difficult to publicize them. The reason is because somehow the operators from where they operate feel threatened that if they are seen collaborating or cooperating with government, they will be seen as traitors by certain persons. And so when we meet, we want to design at the background and only try to manifest our agreements.
And I'm just wondering, how easy or difficult is it going to be now that the Avengers have gone on the ground for your ministry to also have that opportunity to dialogue with them such that they can just sheath their swords?
All it suggests is that we must continue to ensure...